Sand.
Around the World in 80 Days is an adventure comedy, love story, martial arts film, kids film, adult film, fantasy, adventure all rolled into one.
It was like an endurance test, this movie. We shot for 6 months.
It's a literal journey around the world, and it's a metaphorical journey.
You can travel around the world, you see so many different places.
For me, this film is a true adventure film like the ones I saw when I was a child.
It's an old-style classic, big, family-friendly epic.
Background. It's just amazing that you can actually play a part in the movie version of it.
And the opportunity to go make a movie sort of literally around the world, that's a once-in-a-lifetime dream.
What's so exciting was telling this wonderful story at this moment in time in history when anything is possible.
Well then, Fogg, let's see you circumnavigate the world in 80 days.
I'll take your wager!
And I remembered reading the book as a kid, so I picked up the book again. And thought, well, this Jules Verne, we all know him as an amazing writer.
Jules Verne was always like a hero of mine. I loved the book when I read it as a child, and I loved the idea of somebody that could see the future like that.
A lot of his novels involve things that happened in the future that he was right about, the fax machine, you know, submarines. He was amazingly ahead of his time.
He's sort of the first science fiction writer in some ways, along with H.G. Wells, and I guess in a way, the Fogg of our story is closer to Jules Verne himself than the original Phileas Fogg character from the book.
That was the kernel of the idea that made me say, well, if we're going to remake this movie, to make it, you know, stand up to the test of time now, it would be fun to make it in the spirit of Jules Verne. So I made Phileas Fogg an inventor, so that way our character in the movie could be projecting all the things that are going to be happening in the future.
Action!
Ah, so your eye is drawn to what I hope will one day be my crowning achievement.
A giant moth?
It's a flying machine.
The character in the film is quite different from the original David Niven. The original Phileas, he's quite a conservative person, very unemotional, almost purposefully dull. I play him more as a comical character.
49! Eureka! We've done it!
In the book, he's just totally confident. Nothing was ever a problem for him. I mean, the idea is unflappable, and we needed somebody flappable. We needed somebody that was going to change, somebody that was insecure, somebody that had never been out of England. So the idea is that by traveling around the world, he gets more of a sense of himself.
Please, Mr. Ross, the balloon cannot support all this weight.
Your hot hair should compensate, no?
Get off! Let go!
Jackie immediately gravitated to this movie because he thought, I get to do stuff in all different locations that I've never done.
One day I remember my manager called me, Jackie, guess what? Somebody asked you to do Around the World 80 Days. Then I said, yes!
Then he's the guy who meshed martial arts with comedy, and that's why I think everyone loves him so much. So I kind of tried to give him a playground to work on, to do his magic, to do what he's great at.
The world has never seen Jackie Chan the way Jackie Chan is in Around the World in 80 Days. He's throwback to Buster Keaton and Charlie Chaplin. And, you know, those silent film stars that just use their physicality to just make you just laugh out loud. I can't tell you how many takes I broke. And Jackie would come over to me and say, stop laughing, you're not helping.
Stop helping me!
Hey! Jackie!
I think it's the first time that we're asking Jackie to really play, not just to grown-ups, but to kids as well. And he is fantastic at it.
He's just super nice, and especially to nice girls like me.
That's me for the fuck ship. You make me scared. Ship! Ship! Boat! Can I say boat?
right now the audience treat me as like a comedian, yes. Actor, yes. The actor who can fight, yes.
Action.
Hello. Now, you give me some of that money, or...
When it came down to the casting of Phileas Fogg, I thought, let's find somebody who you can truly believe is a genius, yet can also be really funny, but we don't know he's trying to make a joke, and we kind of looked everywhere, and I had seen Steve Coogan, and I thought, this guy, you believe he's a genius, and when he makes a joke, he doesn't do what I call ta-da. You're sort of in the scene with him, and you're like, that was just really funny, and it doesn't seem like he means to be funny, but he is.
He's a really, really British, yeah, everything. All right, but of course.
I've done that, but I haven't done a sorrow myself.
He is Phileas. He really is the guy. And you couldn't ask for a better comic actor to work with.
To me, the world's going to know him now, and they're going to always think, hey, that's Phileas Fogg.
You really believe we can succeed?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes!
There's not many actresses, young actresses, that are beautiful and charming, that have comedic timing like Lucille Ball. Cécile de France has it.
No, c'est pas timide. Yes!
I have a lot of responsibility on my shoulders, especially because English is not my native language. It's important to keep Monique as French as possible, but people must be able to understand her when she speaks English. And I've been lucky to work with an excellent dialogue coach, and she has helped me to understand the rhythm of English, which is so different from French.
Ah, yeah. It's not Kirsten. It's a drop after. It's Kirsten. Yeah.
She just totally lights up the screen. Great comedian.
He also said a Chinese warlord to kill Phileas Fogg.
Let's see how it plays out. I'll be here.
She's tough, but she's still a lady, and she's gorgeous, and she couldn't wait. She kept saying, Frank, I need to hit somebody in the movie. And I was like, good.
Then she'd been practicing like 2 weeks every day, you know, boom.
She'd go around the world twice. She has that much spirit.
Oh, you better put this on. Oh, sorry.
It's okay.
Where are you?
A man who has never set foot out of England, circling the globe. This is going to be rather amusing.
Lord Kelvin was based on a real man who existed. He was a famous scientist who invented the Kelvin temperature scale. But what he's famous for now is kind of examples of stupid things that scientists have said.
We live in a golden age, Fogg. Everything worth discovering has been discovered.
Lord Kelvin said that you'll never have planes that will fly. He said radio waves are impossible. And he said the internal combustion engine was impossible. So when we started talking about this real guy, they said, that's got to be our villain.
Oh, you spineless cretins.
We just thought, who could be a great, colorful villain, but still be very real and be able to push the limits? And we thought of Jim Broadbent, and he just sort of fit that bill perfectly.
This is the Royal Academy of Science! We don't need to prove anything!
He chooses to believe that science and civilization has developed as much as it can, and he wants it to stop. The status quo suits him fine.
Lies, all of it!
It works well as kind of a modern take on what the world's like today as well, because as much as you have people that are trying to move the world forward, you always have people that say, you know, no more.
Lies! All of it! Stop, or I'll wrest you as well!
Ewan Bremner brings a kind of madcap, surreal quality to the part of Inspector Fix.
He's like a human cartoon.
Every time I appear, I really come a cropper. I get my head banged off of walls, I have to jump off buildings and fall out of windows, and I get kicked out of steaming trains, burned with boiling water. I get every nasty thing that could happen to me happens in this film.
I really will!
That is the most gorgeous shot.
The environment Frank creates on the set is pretty incredible. Every day, no matter how hard the day was, everybody's having the best time. I mean, Frank is the happiest guy on the set I've ever worked with.
Frank is like a big kid himself, and always has great ideas. And you know, he'll usually throw out stuff to me, and I'll take it and try to work it and think about how it fits into the script. Our final product is better than either one of us would have come up with on our own.
I love his enthusiasm and his desire to make a movie that is both funny and believable.
If you work with someone creatively who you trust, then you can work much more quickly because you tend to agree on a lot of things. And if you don't agree, you resolve things very quickly and you use a kind of comic shorthand.
This shot would work as they come back out the tent.
It's great to work with someone who is a specialist, as it were, in comedy and knows exactly how the comedic timing works on film.
Now, you... Action!
As a kid, you see the world, you know, from your experiences in movies. And in this movie, we do take you to places. We've shot in about 12 different countries, like the Great Wall in China, stuff in Paris and stuff in London, in the United States as well. We shot in the desert. So we kind of tried to take people as many places as we could go. The majority of it was shot in Berlin and Thailand.
Our strategy was to choose a couple places that we could use that would work for many different parts. And we ended up coming to Berlin because we could shoot London here, we could shoot France.
Because it was East Berlin, it hasn't really been that built up yet in a lot of areas. So we got to find classic English architecture, but it was really huge. There was areas in East Berlin that had these enormous buildings with big columns, and it was perfect for our sort of storybook world we were creating. Thailand, it was just gorgeous. It was just luscious. It was beautiful. It played as China in the movie. But we found this location in the middle of these giant monoliths that maybe were like 2,000 feet. And we built this whole village where Passepartout is from, with a beautiful temple, and it played also for India.
We have traveled many cities, long hours, charters around the world, and the crew has really pulled it together.
Let's get ready to shoot. Very good. Here we go.
The first day of photography, we had over 700 crew in Thailand, and it was just an amazing number.
Background.
My village.
Your village?
I mean, my, what a village.
Not only do we shoot in many different locations across the world, but we have many different languages that are spoken on set. So we have many different interpreters to interpret the languages.
Geht's los, und alle strömen daher. Kannst du noch ein bisschen weiter ausdünnen?
There's so many translation going on. And blah, 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 Jackie, you just say yes, okay.
Now, what makes you different from them?
I'm hungry and miserable.
No, you stink.
On this movie, there were so many cameos that it's part of the treat of going around the world, of who are we going to meet around this next turn.
If you've got any, lotion for hands, you know, what could use it?
And we were constantly creating on the set, which some of the funniest lines, you know, happened when we were doing it.
It was great fun working with Frank because I didn't really know what the dialogue was going to be. Originally, there were two couple of lines, and we just rejigged it a little bit, and suddenly that was the scene.
Sir, rumor has it a flying machine is heading for the Royal Academy. Our bank thief at the pedals.
Some people will believe anything.
Working with John Cleese was awesome. He's always been an idol of mine, and I got all nervous being in his presence because he's just so great.
Well done, lad.
I love the fact that this is a family film where, you know, parents and kids go and laugh together, and that's marvelous when that happens.
See what I mean?
Quiet! I love being able to do that.
I love Kathy Bates. She's like, Frank, it's like coming in a basketball game with 2 minutes left and having to make a foul shot. And I said, don't worry, Kathy, we'll figure it out. And she just became Queen Victoria.
I'm practicing my dialogue the whole day. I'm practicing because she's Kathy Bates. I don't want to do something bad on the set until she forget her dialogue.
Sorry.
Ah, that makes me... Oh, even Kathy Bay forget her dialogue.
Okay, you go first.
Quite a contraption you got here, Mr. Fogg.
Phileas Fogg is really a man of the future. His inventions sort of look like they came from the 1890s. We really wanted to make them feel like he was much more of a visionary. You know, they're kind of crazy and eclectic and a little bit of future retro in a way.
And the throttle in your right hand controls the speed.
We talked about the jetpack, and wouldn't it be cool if the jetpack was really like a big jet engine on his back? I thought, well, a barrel looks like that. Then we incorporated all these sort of exhaust pipes, and those look like they're made out of a saxophone or a trumpet. And it actually was really cool for me to do it, because it's almost like I was a kid and I just got to like think up things and just make them out of all these different crazy parts.
Two, one.
There's lots of wonderful mechanical gadgetry that we have to create, build for this show. When Phileas Fogg meets Passepartout for the first time at his home, we have created like a roller coaster set in his front courtyard, a roller coaster with a hydraulically propelled sledge which goes around it.
But everything made sense. That was the key with all the inventions. Everything had to be logical. So you're not just seeing fluff, you're actually seeing something that, wow, this guy thought of that. That's really smart.
The flying machine had to be Phileas's ultimate invention. We wanted it to look futuristic, almost like a modern-day jet, but yet it still has this sort of chitty-chitty-bang-bang feeling.
That noise, by the way, was my flying machine crashing in front of the Royal Academy of Science.
It was tricky, and I thought we were going to be in trouble because it's got an enormous wingspan, more like a kite than a plane.
Most of the flying machine was actually shot on a green screen, and the actors were kind of stuck up there while we shot it, dangling 40 feet above the ground, 5 hours at a time, but they heroically act out this amazing action.
Action! Passepartout, ready?
Ready!
Turn left!
Later we composited into some real sky backgrounds with clouds wisping by, and it's one of the most fun set pieces in the movie, and it is Phileas Fogg achieving his ultimate dream of flying.
Come in.
We set our watches forward at 24 time zones, so here it's still day 79.
So we've
won!
I think the great thing about this film is it reassures people that the world is an interesting place with people from very different backgrounds and different cultures, and a more friendly, more colourful place.
You get to see the world. It's a great family adventure film for everybody.
It's about love, peace, and friendship.
Everybody wants to go on a ride, you know, and I just want to give people a ride that's exciting, funny, you know, emotional. And I feel like this movie has it all. It has all those things in it. And you kind of walk away going, wow, I just went around the world.